Hi, this is Chef Rick Moonen, interviewing from my studio in Las Vegas. The name of my podcast is Ocean Raised. Here's where I get to dive deep into storytelling with some of the original gangsters of cuisine to find out where they started and what drives them today. Today, I connect with an amazing chef and a longtime friend who has a heart as big as a country, or should I say several countries, and a creative culinary talent that is both enviable and diverse. If you have never heard of the term mensch before, you will understand its meaning by the end of this podcast. Chef Jeffrey Mora did his formal apprenticeship under certified master chef Raymond Hofmeister at the Century Plaza Hotel from 1984 to 1988. From there, he worked at a two-star Michelin restaurant, Swan Hotel in Osterwijk under Chef Kaz Spikers. I know I'm going to butcher some of these names, Chef, and I apologize right up front. But
that's okay, pal.
Thanks. Chef Mora was on the United States National Culinary Olympic team from 1992 through 1996. Since then, he cooked in more than 22 countries around the world. Jeffrey's been involved in all aspects of the food service industry, from Michelin star restaurants to setting up Royal Caribbean day ports food service operations. Jeffrey was the corporate chef for the New Zealand Trade Board, overseeing all food and beverage into the United States market. Jeffrey also set up the Mora family business in the Burbank Airport in Los Angeles, California, with over 9 outlets serving over 5,000 meals per day. Chef Jeffrey has also personally took care of the LA Lakers food service, providing all meal periods for the entire team and seasons for 8 years, including a 3-year title run with 2 world titles. And he has the championship rings to prove it. Jeffrey has spent the last 20 plus years in the sustainability environmental movement, which is incredibly interesting to me. He helped put on one of the first sustainable cuisine dinners in New York City in 1998 with the Earth Pledge Foundation. He sits on the board of the Carbon Underground for Regenerative Farming, the Green Sports Alliance, the Pioneers of Sustainability with Jean-Michel Jacques Cousteau's son, right? I believe Jean-Michel. Ocean Future Society is his organization, where he spent 2 months cooking on expedition in the Amazon. He's currently working on a project with the Minister of Agriculture in Thailand. Jeff's also a chef owner of Food Fleet. Now, Food Fleet manages food truck operations nationally for corporate clients. They design, develop, and build trucks and pop-up units for clients and specialize in working with environmental health on behalf of the owners and helping trucks increase traction times, transition times, helps them speed up. Food Fleet is able to design, build trucks, and put a new truck on the road in as little as 4 weeks. They provide everything from concept, menu development, training, as well as route scheduling. Food Fleet is also a premier food truck booking company, specializing in large and small scale events tailored to fit their clients' needs. They work with the top corporate food service giants from in the United States, from Sodexo, Levy Restaurants, Restaurant Associates, Delaware North, ISS, and the Irvine Company. That pretty much covers all the best food service that large companies and arenas around the country run and operate. And Jeffrey works closely with them. His company, Food Fleet, provides daily as well as special event services. So they work closely with their clients to help increase employee satisfaction ratings and give options to clients whose needs range from temporary food service to servicing locations on a daily basis. They work with all the trucks in order to provide nutritionally based meals to their clients. Food Fleet has expertise in all aspects of the food truck and pop-up industry. Most recently, Food Fleet consulting launched to help startups and major brands develop clean label products across all platforms of manufacturing, from fresh, frozen, UHT, and retort. Specialties, product development, contract management, purchasing, recipe development, kitchen and mobile unit design, large scale catering, restaurant design and construction, fast food, quick service, mid-scale dining, fine dining, all with the background of Michelin stars. I feel super, super privileged to have a very good friend and mensch, Jeffrey Mora, here with me today. Jeff, thanks for coming by. I appreciate you speaking with me.
That needs to follow up, found dead in his LA home.
And it didn't come easy. This is what I know. I've known you, Jeffrey, for so many years. You are just a chef's chef, you know, and your name's out up there in Celebrity Lights. You're not going after that. You're doing it for the good of the good. You know, your heart is really, truly, truly in the right place. So in the normal formation or format of Ocean Race, I like to get a little bit of way back information. Jeff, where were you born and raised? How many siblings did you have? I mean, what I'm trying to extract out of you in your own words is, where did your love of cuisine come into play before you started to go on your big travel of life?
So I grew up in New York, born like you, out on Long Island. Both my parents were both Holocaust survivors. My father was in four camps and on Schindler's List.
Wow.
My mother in Auschwitz. They came over a couple years after the war into New York. Mm. My dad ended up having the barbershop. He was a barber at Stony Brook University back in the 60s. Back then, Stony Brook had nothing. As you remember, Long Island was sod farms and potato farms.
Ducks.
And lots of great fishing, you know. Right. We grew up, we had a small boat, and we went out every day in the summer. It was exceptional.
Early exposure to the ocean, which makes a lot of sense.
Every day, growing up. Yeah, we were walking distance.
Yeah, so that there's your tie in, just from being a kid and like being completely surrounded and immersed in it. You know, that's where I'm assuming your love of the environment and seeing what goes on over the years, you know, transpire that you're an environmentalist. You know, same with me. I didn't plan on becoming an environmentalist. It just came about naturally from giving a darn where food comes from and what controls it.
Well, think about it. You and I grew up around the same time, right? So Sunday nights was Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom.
Yes.
Right? And Jacques Cousteau. And those two things were, you know, extremely influential.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, unbelievably so. When I got to meet Jacques' son, Jean-Michel, it was without a doubt one of my heroes, right? From a kid, I couldn't believe how that ever happened, right? So,
you know, when I was a kid, I would watch, when I watched TV, because I was extremely hyperactive and running around. So television, what caught my
Nothing's
eye?
Nothing's changed, but that's okay, pal.
Well, not really. I don't know. I'm 65 now. I still feel 20.
Yeah.
It's insane. This industry, I would do it all over again. But it was the Galloping Gourmet, you know, Graham Kerr on television, just having a blast. And I just, it mesmerized me because something about the way he was presenting cuisine of the world allowed me to travel through his demonstrations, cooking experience. And he was having a blast. He was half in the bag half the time. I didn't know that until I got to meet him later on.
Yeah.
But then I met him later on in my life, just like, you know, you got to meet Cousteau. And it's just, it's our epiphanies that bring us to our successful levels of however we define that. But brothers and sisters?
Two brothers, twin brother.
Mm-hmm.
Who lives here, who runs the airport business for us, mm-hmm. for the family. The other one lives up north. But my mom was an exceptional cook, Hungarian. So my mom was from Hungary, my dad from Poland. You may remember in Manhattan on the Upper East Side, there was a Hungarian bakery called Rigo's.
May or may not.
It's in the 70s. It was one of the family Hungarian bakeries. It was a cousin of my mother's. But she was an exceptional cook. My dad's partner was another Italian barber. His partner and his wife were exceptional cooks. So every Sunday was Sunday dinner at their house, you know, in the basement with the wine, the music. It was a great way to grow up.
Yeah.
It really was. So I was never exposed to bad food, which never hurts, right?
Well,
I got a love for it that way.
So is that where your interest in cooking or food started? I mean, you were eating well, but when did you get, wow, I would like to do this. How did that
When I was 16, I started really like looking at it and enjoying it more and cooking for potlucks and different things like that, right? We moved out to California at that point. Mm-hmm. I got a little older. At 18, I was doing more, right? At 20, I really wanted to do it. So I was very fortunate. One of my dad's customers ran Old Country Bakery, which is part of Orowee, big company on the West Coast. And he went to, my dad went to him and said, you know, he wants to learn how to cook. Well, where is he going to go? It was a small program, the ACF, the American Culinary Federation, shit the head, the president out here, had a small little six-month program at Cerritos. And I went there and I really loved it. I couldn't get enough. You know, the book back then he taught us, and still to this day, classical cooking the modern way, right?
I know that book very well.
Yeah. And fortunately enough, the Century Plaza was opening the tower. That program was 6 months. So right around December, the tower was opening and they were hiring. So I got an interview as a pantry. Knowing that he took on apprentices, Hoffmeister was his name, and he wasn't a master chef at that point. He took his test while I was there. But they were opening the tower. I got a job. I will tell you, I was terrified, as you know, walking into a hotel kitchen. They all spoke German. Being Jewish, that didn't go over. Although my Yiddish was pretty good because of my mom and dad, right? But I will tell you, the very first day on the job, they had two of the giant rotating ovens, the ones that held six sheet pans in on a rack and then six rack. Shells. Wow. Correct. Two of them side by side.
36 sheet pans times two.
Correct.
72 sheet pans. That's a lot of sheet.
Two ovens like that in the banquet area, right? And my first day, I go in the kitchen. They put me at a sink. There must have been 300 pounds of shrimp. Go peel them, right? That was about 4 hours in. I realized I'm allergic.
Okay, great.
My hands are swollen, and I'm terrified to say anything. Literally. I mean, just swollen. I'm like, I got to say something, right? So I turn around. There was an extern from the CIA putting chickens in the oven, but he put the sheet pans in straight instead of sideways. Right. 75 chickens went bam at the top of the oven, went to the bottom of the oven.
Yeah.
I'm watching this happen, standing back, right? Not even near it, because I wasn't even. The two executive sous, which were 6'6", 300 pounds each, I kid you not.
Germans.
One was Dutch, one was American, but spoke German.
Right.
They turned the oven off. Not that that does any good, as you know, right? they put sheet pans in the oven. They gave him a meat fork. They picked him up. They put him in the oven, and they made him go get them. All those chickens. I swear to you, this is December 1984.
Did that extern last for an entire externship?
I turned around and went right back to the sink and shut my mouth. And I'm thinking, well, think about this irony, okay? I'm a Jew in a German kitchen and watching them put a guy in the oven.
I know. I didn't want to say it. I'm glad it came out of your mouth.
Oh, it did. Yeah. I was like, this is not good. I did not tell mom and dad that. But I fought every day there on that job to keep it and to excel. Hoffmeister only took two apprentices every 6 months. Weston had that training program, right? So every Weston hotel took apprentices. But there were six guys vying for those two positions. There was four vying for the two spots.
Got it.
So every day I came in, I probably was doing 100 hours a week. Mm-hmm. Till 6 months later, he took two. And we were all so good, he took all four. First time ever. But unbeknownst to me, not until last year did I know this. My father went and spoke to Hoffmeister a number of times about me getting the apprenticeship, about making sure, you know, because Europe, it was apprenticeships, right? And that's where your father put you into an apprenticeship, right? I didn't find this out till last year. My father's passed away 7 years ago. I didn't even know he went, the old man, Hoffmeister, told me, your father came in multiple times to see me.
You throw me crazy. I said, all right, bring in the boy.
Oh, that's a given. Oh, there was plenty of that. But I definitely, you know, I was in childcare before that. I literally was in after-school daycare doing that. So to go into a kitchen where you know you, if you didn't stand up for yourself, you are not going to last too long.
Well, you learned early on that you had to make yourself irreplaceable every single day you went into the kitchen. And if that meant 12, 14 hours, that's what it was.
Oh, at least, right? I mean, at the very least. My shift started 2 to 10 for the first 6-8 months. Mm-hmm. I'll give you two quick stories, right?
Yeah, that's what we're talking about.
Yeah, I would show up 9 or 10 in the morning and just stay till midnight. This was the only way to learn. You can't learn on shift.
No.
The only way you're going to get anything is that. So the banquet kitchen was 3,000 meals a day on average, 10 months a year. And it was all platter service back then.
Right.
So the main saucier was a Chinese guy by the name of Jimmy Wong. And he was, Walter Roth was the corporate chef for Weston. So he and, I'll remember his name at the Greenbrier, were the two that started the apprenticeships really in the U.S. Walter Roth and, I'll remember his name. I have it here somewhere. But anyway, Jimmy Wong he brought him down from the Vancouver Westin at the time and opened the Century Plaza in 1971.
Where's the Century Plaza?
In Century City.
Okay.
California. Yeah. So Jimmy was the banquet saucier for that hotel, right? Every Westin chef that was an executive chef had to come and Jimmy had to sign off on the guy. If Jimmy didn't approve you, you were out. I mean, and you're talking about guys like Hartman Hanke and Victor Galise and, you know,
big names
all went through there. And if he let you, you know, live basically, you know, you were good to go. Because look, the heart of every hotel is a banquet. If you're not good at banquets, the restaurants are irrelevant. They're the lost leaders, right?
They didn't have the bases and powders and all sorts of, you know,
things that would come out
later. Everything was bones in the oven, cooking, doing it properly, extracting all of the, what we call bone broth today. It's kind of a joke when I saw bone broth. You're like,
right.
Yeah, I mean, what other broth, where else does it come from, you know? But back then, that's the only way there was. And in order to, and I'm just kind of repeating what you're saying to clarify for those that are listening. Okay, I know I'm not preaching to you because I was lucky enough to become saucier in my career. And I know all the crazy pressures that are on you. You know, it's quite a position. So that's a hard program to pass through.
Well, this guy would do a 90 yolk hollandaise to start in the morning. Think about that, right?
By hand. Yeah. Did he have Popeye arms or what? That's crazy.
Sunday was 120.
How many pounds of butter going to that many egg yolks?
It's 5 gallons.
Something like that, right?
Yeah.
So, all right, everyone listening.
Anyway,
imagine this gigantic bowl the size of God knows what.
And this guy was not, right? So every morning I made sure whenever I came in, I went in, said good morning to him, and then went to work, right? Said hello, paid my respects. But I would sit there and keep an eye on that station, right? Because all the other apprentices and all the guys are, you know how you get ribbed, right? Well, he's going to chew you up. He's going to pitch you out. He would chase guys with a cleaver. He wouldn't show you how to do stuff, right? He was one of those guys, you know, if I show you how you take my job. You remember that was the old days, right?
Yeah.
You know what? It was exactly it. If I show you, you're going to take my job. So he would point for a guy to go get him something. They come back, the thing would be done. Or he'd go in the walk-in and mix it and come back out, right? So this guy liked clockwork, and he would do 1,000 by himself for lunch. Sear off the protein, make the sauce, plate it up. Literally, I had a help for plate up. But cooking, 1,000 by himself every day.
So what kind of dishes are there at this point? When you
chicken Dijon and chicken Dijon, different fish, meat dishes,
probably
all the classical stuff, right?
Yeah.
But he would, that was the deal, right? So if he didn't like you, you weren't going for it, right? So they warned you, right? So he was this guy, 10 minutes to 6 every morning, he would come in, set a station, 6 o'clock, he would clock in, go upstairs to the cafeteria, get himself a cup of coffee, relax for 10 minutes, think about his day, come back down, work till 10 o'clock, take a break, come back down and dish up lunch. every day like clockwork. So my first day, you know, I got there at 5 o'clock and set a station. Put the pots where they were. I wrote a diagram.
Wait, 5 a.m.?
I got in at 5, right? Before he got there, I set up his station. I had diagrams that I had kept an eye on and showed up at the right time to know how many saucepans, how many stock pots, how many tongs, ladles, everything that that guy needed to that he did in his 10 minutes. When he walked in my first day, he looked, he smiled. I said, he went up to get his coffee and he was done. From that point on, he and I were good friends. I mean, he knew I respected him enough to go and do. So he didn't have to set up a station ever again when I was there.
So would you consider him your mentor?
Oh, with banquets? Oh my God, without a doubt. There was, Rick, if I tell you, the guy did, so he had 12 of those big 14-inch pans for omelets in the morning. Mm-hmm. If you were, we had the big French heavy oval platters. So 120 omelets would serve 1,200 people. Two chopsticks in his hand, literally. He would take the eggs and put them in the bain-marie to get them just to the point. Those pans would go on at 6 o'clock. He would have six rotated, right? Big pans. He would literally take a 24-ounce, I forgot, or 48-ounce ladle, I don't remember, into the pan. Woof, woof, lift it up. Two chopsticks, right? A perfect, absolute perfect French rolled omelet with not one brown mark on it. And bam, onto the pan, and next. He was rotating six of these. 10 minutes to do 120 omelets. 10 minutes. Never in my life. Literally, my first day there, right, when he did omelets, Jeffrey, you just stand there. What? Pat the omelet with the towel, right? Put it in the hot box. That was my job. I could barely keep up. Literally, this guy, he would do a banquet for 1,000 with the chickens, but he showed you how the airline breasts, right? 60 chickens on two sheet pans for 30, right? Bam, 30 one way, bam, 30 the other, seared, right? Dipped in flour, flip one row, the starting row, outward, back over, into a black pan with mirepoix on the bottom with some chicken stock and ready to go. But I mean, 1,000 in nothing, right? Think about it, you're banging 60 at a time on the flat top.
So you worked there with him for what, 2 years?
Well, look, it was the apprenticeship. So it was 6 months of station, pretty much.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But he would do a banquet of 1,000 and platter service, right? He would have literally 8 ounces of sauce left over. I mean, you were blown away. I mean, the guy was just, anytime there was a VIP and we had, you know, every chef was from Europe on the sous chef side and a lot of J1 visas. Anytime there was a VIP or a Escoffier dinner, Jimmy made the consomme. Hofmeister wouldn't let anyone else go near it. I mean, you had guys from Switzerland and Germany and Austria. Jimmy's making the consomme. Oh, chef, I'm better than, you're not even close to this guy. Don't even. And he walked out a couple of times. Would go, F you, carry a cleaver. Hofmeister told me.
Get back here.
Hofmeister told me when he first came to the hotel, he was 28 or 29, came from the Carlton in South Africa, worked at a couple of the Westons, right? This was the flagship hotel.
Yeah.
And Walter Roth said, you know, you better make sure you got Jimmy, because you don't got Jimmy, you got nothing. Oh, I don't need that guy. And Jimmy walked out. Oof. And Walter Roth said, you want to keep this job? You better go apologize. You better go get that guy back.
That was your job to do that?
No. This was one before I was, long before I was there.
Oh, okay.
When Hofmeister took over the hotel, Jimmy walked out. I'm not working for this young kid. That's what he said, Roth. And he walked out. And Hofmeister thought, I don't need this guy. And Walter said, a couple days on that station, and he
needed that guy.
I mean, it that guy was invaluable. Literally, I would tell you, the training was so phenomenal. Corporate chef would come in, Walter Roth, and drill you as an apprentice with your manual, your books, all that. How do you make this? How do you do that? Right. So every couple of months, he'd come in, and you'd sit in the chef's table room, and he just, for an hour, he just go to town. You know, what's a bechamel? What's a velouté? You know, what's a...
How did you learn this? I mean, did you learn all this through Eugene Pauly's book?
Mostly, yeah. And my apprenticeship, right? But all through Pauly, right? Mm-hmm. How many sides to a chateau potato? All that, right? It was the way we learned, right?
So you didn't go to culinary school, but you learned through the school of hard knocks in reality.
It was a formal apprenticeship. There were 6,000 hours. There was school once a week. Mm-hmm. So it was. I mean, when we graduated with a diploma from the state, from the union, and from Weston Hotels. Okay. Those papers were good globally. You can get a job anywhere.
So where'd you go from there?
From there, I went to a small country club. And I was an apprentice on the 88 Western Culinary Olympic team.
Okay.
One of the chefs was there. Really good guy. I liked him a lot. He was a little bit more fun to be around. So I was like, I was tired of getting beat. Yeah. So I went there. And then I went to the DoubleTree Hotel in Pasadena and opened that hotel as executive sous, and then got the family business and then started traveling.
Gotcha.
But I spent a lot of time in Holland because that chef came over to the Century Plaza and I got assigned to him. Cas Spijkers was a 2 Michelin star in the south of Holland, became one of my big mentors. And I spent years there on and off.
What did you learn from him? I mean, now you've got volume and classic cuisine. Pretty much you've got a taste of everything, whether you've conquered it yet at this point of your career or not. You've certainly gotten a rounded exposure to it all. So what did you learn in Holland?
Look, it was 2 Michelin star, right?
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying.
It was execution, technique, that level of food on a day-to-day is... You know, it teaches you not to compromise and not to settle, right? It teaches you. This guy was probably the most creative. He was one of the first judges for the Bocuse d'Or.
Okay.
I would tell you, from a succession of creativity and modern cuisine, the Dutch were way ahead of most, because if you went to France, you only got French food. You went to Germany, you only got German food. You went to Italy, you only got Italian back then, right?
Yeah.
You went to Holland because they were explorers and conquerors. There was no true Dutch cuisine. It was fusion to a point, right? He could do Japanese, he could do Indonesian. There was French, there was German. It was
it's like Switzerland a little bit, right?
A lot like Switzerland, right? But if you were in the German part of Switzerland, it was more that, right? So... But from that standpoint, it really was pretty amazing. The guy made his own cheese, made his own vinegars, made his own. He was the most creative. Literally, it went from him to Adria. So we were doing sous vide back in 88 and 89. He learned from Alain Chappelle, the guy who brought it from the commercialization to the kitchen.
So did they have
a combi oven in there doing rillette in a cryovac bag, 1 degree at a time, bringing it up?
That's crazy. They didn't have thermal circulators back there then either.
No.
So how did they regulate the temperatures?
Combi ovens. The steam in the combi.
Combi oven is short for combination ovens.
Right. So it was a steam injected oven, right? Mm-hmm. He also was doing meat injection back then, right? And those types of things. The guy was incredible.
So how did you get involved in cooking competitions? And tell me a little bit about that experience, because that intrigues me, I'll tell you.
Yeah, so Hofmeister was on the 84 national team, on the U.S. Culinary Olympic team. He was also on the Luxembourg team. So I had got that experience from being in the hotel, and it drove me to, and that really does teach you discipline as well. It allows some creativity when you're doing the same thing every day. So 1990 comes along and the tryouts for the U.S. team come along. So I went ahead and tried out and made the team in 92 and 96. But I get a lot of seafood challenges back then. You remember, there's a lot of those competitions and I enjoyed it, right? So
a lot of
it was
fish
another
mousse.
Discipline. Huh?
A lot of fish mousse.
a lot of fish mousse, a lot of chicken mousse, a lot of aspic.
Yes.
Oh my God, if I never smell aspic again in my life, it'll be too soon.
I know the smell you're talking about too.
Just the glazing and the hours and
chauffeur,
a lot of that. But it really taught you to think on your feet, to not let anything, because typically if you were doing a food competition, you were displaying that cold food. You had to be on the table and out the door by 6 a.m., which means you're on 24 hours to 48 hours at a time preparing.
So now you got all of that going for you. And now how did you start to embrace or take a deeper interest in environmental or sustainability issues?
So it's a funny story. I was, and this is how you and I met, right? I was doing the New Zealand trade stuff and the Savannah stuff,
exactly. Right?
Out of the trade board in LA. I had met on one of the trips down in New Zealand, an actress by the name of Jennifer O'Neill. Mm-hmm. You would remember her, right? Summer of 42. Most people on the podcast would not have a clue. that being said, I met her on the flight back to New Zealand. Long story short, we became good friends. And her daughter was doing an environmental furniture store in Brentwood. And it was supposed to be like 100 people. You know, can you do the opening party? It's tied in with a group called Echo, the Earth Communications Office, right? And I said, sure, no problem. For 100 people, I'll get the trade board. I'll get some, you know, lamb, mussel, seafood, venison donated. I'll take care of it. You just got to cover the wait staff, but I got the rest. So longer story short, it turns into 600 people.
Like it does.
Yes, right, like it does, right? And a good friend of ours, who you know too, Larry Copald, was the president of Echo at the time.
Okay.
So me being the New Yorker that I am, and you being, you know, I don't want to use the A word, but the head guy from Echo calls me up and says, I can't serve lamb and I can't serve duck, right? I'm like, first of all, it's New Zealand. And I'm like, I'm donating this. These people are, and like you, give me a reason. If you give me a good enough reason, I got no problem. But if you can't give me a reason, then I'm not, just because it's not a reason.
Right.
So figure it out. And I never got a reason. So just to be myself, right? I cooked everything in duck fat. The fish, I mean, everything. I literally, pal, everything, right? So Larry walks in. He goes, the food is amazing. Why does it taste so good? Because I cooked everything in duck fat. And he hit the floor laughing. And we became really good friends from that point. I knew nothing about environmentalism. Not a lot, right? I knew it was an issue, a cause, but food sustainability, no clue. So Larry dragged me in and got me involved with Echo, and I realized they needed food and all that. And it drove me more and more into that till we did that dinner in 98 with Michelle and you and the rest back in 98.
Yeah.
So that's how I got involved with them. And then I got involved. Larry was on the board of American Oceans Campaign. I ended up on that board, NRDCE2. Oh yeah. I mean, and I just kept going in that world because I realized A, they needed help, right? And B, they needed somebody like you that understands business, understands people's motivations, and understands that you can't just tell people what to do. You know, at the end of the day, you need to always understand that if you don't check the box about the what's in it for me, you're not getting anybody to do anything. They will for a short period of time, even if it's the right thing. It doesn't matter.
But getting them to care, I would say.
Getting them to care is right. But still, even to that point, you still need to make sure what's their motivating factor. That's the what's in it for me. Mm-hmm. Is it money? Is it doing good? Is it helping my family? You know, when we do this work and this stuff with the stadiums and that, right? I tell guys like, you know, right? At when you're trying to implement sustainability, and you're trying to implement this at stadiums, And I saw it with Justin with the Green Sports Alliance. You have somebody go up there and preach the local this, that, the other. But if they can't bring it all the way down to the guy doing the job in that stadium, you know, most people don't realize the chef at Staples Center or, you know, Vegas, those arenas, or the chef at the casino, 1 point of his food cost is more than his annual salary.
Yeah. Yeah, it's big money.
1 point of his food cost, right? He may be making $1.50 a year or $2.50 these days, right? But in Vegas, at a casino, that's not even 1 point.
That's right? Correct.
He's responsible for $100 million or more dollars. So the guy making the least amount of money is responsible for the most amount of money. But that being said, changing his budget, having him buy better, having him source better, right? If he's not making his bonus and his kids aren't going to camp in the summer, where's his motivation? You got to help that guy get there, right? You got to figure out that it, can it meet a 25% food cost? Can I do this? Where am I going to offset it? Can I tell a good enough story that people will charge more? If you don't check those boxes, the program's going to fail.
It's tough, man.
It just because is, right?
Usually when you're sourcing out protein, doesn't matter, produce, dairy, pick all the categories, and you want to have the story, as you say, and that's exactly what it is. It's the story. And you want it to be pure, better, or at least sustainable, so that you're not using up the resources. It's more expensive, generally speaking, correct? So you had to be extremely creative in order to A, charge a little bit more than everyone else is because you're doing it right, or B, prepare it in a certain way that you're utilizing every single little piece of every scrap of everything so that you can meet your food costs. Like you said, 1%, you know, that's a food cost percent. 25% food cost is actually very, very good as a general. I mean, 33 is probably the average across.
For a restaurant, right?
For a restaurant, right.
For hotels, for stadiums, right? That also are paying that giant rent. Mm-hmm. They're operating, you know, those coliseums, those arenas, they're at 25 because of the rent they got to pay, because of the labor, and everything else. So they got the suites are a little different, obviously, right?
Yeah.
But
they have a bigger budget.
Right, but it's the rent, right? A restaurant food cost, you're right, 30 to 33 is the average.
Right.
Right. But the way I look at it now, and I've been saying it for quite a while, to me, it's the Patagonia effect. Without the story, without understanding what Patagonia does, you're not spending that type of money for that piece of clothes. You're just not. Give me a reason why. They do a phenomenal job of telling you why it costs you that much. And people will pay. They don't mind at that point, right?
What I find out really extremely interesting about, because this is, without people like you doing what you do, what I was trying to do is, you know, kind of convey some mentality, some embrace of our environment and make sure that it remains healthy. Because I learned early on that the best food, great food comes from a happy, great environment. So without bringing it all the way back to, well, as if it's destroying the ocean floor, if it's just destroying, you know, the health of the soil, you know, we've got history of, you know, that can prove that we didn't do a great job of it, you know, but you helped inject that into a gigantic number, you know, because of your path, which I just find amazingly admirable.
Well, thank you.
It's just, yeah, but it's not easy. That's I'm waiting for you. No, that's your cue to go, yeah, Moon, and that's awesome. But it was no cakewalk, you know.
Tell me. No, it isn't, but that's the point. Guys like you and me that have amassed this much skill, right? And this much knowing how to utilize trim. Knowing how to utilize second cuts, like a lobster roll, right? If I'm doing a lobster roll, forget about the price these days, right? Because everything's out the window, right?
Yeah.
But if you legally, sadly, right? If it's 51% lobster, then you can call it a lobster roll.
Your scallops.
but not surimi, right? But I'm saying you could go with shrimp and lobster. You could go with knuckle. You could go with, you know, with leg meat. You can go with different things to get you to that price point on a sustainability side to be able to serve a lobster roll at a reasonable price.
Absolutely. Right? Absolutely.
It's mix and match to be able to do it the right way, right? Or it's utilizing the belly and the trim on the salmon.
Yeah. Yeah. People throw the belly on.
Your Moondogs were utilizing trim in that.
That's right. Right. That's right.
So, but and that's affordable. So you got it. People don't realize seafood is the most expensive thing on a menu.
And it should be. I mean, not really.
I get it. It is a lot of work, but I'm saying they don't realize it is double or triple because regular other proteins can be extremely dirt cheap, right?
Well, and chicken, also it's
their pork, beef. In general, the lower cuts are not to get a good piece of fish compared to, you know, meat, it is going to cost you more. So it is more perishable.
All right, I have a little theory about this that I think you'll agree with. All right, when it comes to seafood, you got to realize one thing: fish, they're carnivorous. They eat meat to grow. So in order to feed them, if you're farming them, that becomes a big challenge and a very huge cost. You know, and if you're going for wild only, let's just say you don't do farm, aquaculture is out of the question. And there was a career in my part of my career where I felt that way. I changed my mind as I learned more and evolved. But it's not cheap to go. You're hunting, you're fishing, you're not catching. You're not going catching today. We're going fishing today. And in a commercial mentality, that's a big crew, a lot of gas, a lot of time, and no guarantee. So seafood.
And you're putting your life on the line.
Absolutely right. Absolutely. Deadliest catch.
It's a dangerous profession that is not easy. Yeah. You know, it's a limited resource in general, right? So it is, I guess, out of all the sustainability, seafood can be the toughest because it's not as, while the sustainability rules are definable to a point, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's a wave, right? In Alaska, it's not the same as in Indonesia, no. As opposed to, right? So it's, where's it coming from? Where's it traveled? You know, it's not like you're farming where everything is in an acre or 1,000 acres, whatever it is. It's a lot more controllable. Even farm fishing is a difficult task, right? It's more controllable, but that doesn't mean much, right? It's a difficult living. Right?
What's your feeling about aquaculture today?
I think it's gotten a lot better. It does every year improve. I really believe that. I think it does need to figure out, and there's, you may know who Dr. Zohar is.
Zohar
is doing land-based fish farming, University of Baltimore, Maryland. Right. This guy figured out how to breed bluefin tuna, Israeli scientist, unbelievable. He's fish farming skipjack and a lot of saltwater species.
Is he farming live fish or is he making fish mussels?
Because no.
That's live also fish. A science.
Yeah, no, that's another whole Frankenstein stuff I'm not
that's
interested
kind,
in.
That's kind of weird, man. Can't wait to check that out. But
yeah, but it would be amazing, right? Look, but that being said, land-based farming in tanks is doable now. It really is. It's unbelievable. And to be able to farm salmon or skipjack or other species, lutamere, things like that, within 100 miles of a city and have these farms, I think is what's next. I think it's more controllable from a pollution standpoint, from a total utilization standpoint, from a processing standpoint, if you think about it, right? It's really difficult to catch this stuff out. Look, fuel costs are ridiculous at this point.
Okay. These boats. Why is land better?
I don't know if it's better. I think it's more contained. Okay. You're controlling the entire system from the sprats not being able to get loose, right?
Well, yeah.
All that, right?
Well, I mean, the the hatcheries need to be online.
Correct. Right.
Because that's a highly controlled environment for sure.
Right. Keeping wild, wild, keeping, you know, non-wild, non-wild. Mm-hmm. Land justice seems to be an easier thing to contain. I'm not saying it's better, right? Figured out the current and the movement to keep fish constantly moving, which they need for a good solid muscle,
for them to be
which is you don't always get with farm fish.
Gotcha. So let me just throw some ideas in
there. Please.
Now let's talk about offshore. I mean, it is well known that the concentration of biomass living, whether they make our dinner table or not, the higher focus and concentration of biomass is within the first mile of the shoreline, but then it drops off and the waters are open waters and a lot more
dead zones.
Well, not necessarily dead zones.
Well, you know, what I mean by that is there's not as much algae and not as much krill or that whole, the system is a lot lower in the bottom of the ocean. So by dead zone, I mean, it's not as plentiful, full of multiple species.
Perhaps deep down, very deep down, but further up towards the surface of the water, past a mile out, now you've got yourself an environment where really good aquaculture companies such as Forever Oceans are setting up shop. And they're doing, and they've got a plan on doing it in a manner in which they're actually giving back to the environment. In other words, you obtain a parcel of the ocean that you're allowed to do your aquaculture facility within. It's offshore, way offshore. And you create these pods that are, all completely computerized, mechanical. So feeding, everything else is being monitored by close camera circuits, it's everything else, cleaning of the nets, everything is automated to that point. And you focus on species of fish that are highly prized and also not as easy to obtain on a regular basis. Done in an environment that's got a great story. The feed, again, there's a lot of different moving parts. Feed alone, because they're carnivorous, where does that marine protein come from? Many times it needs to be more than 50% of the fish feed needs to be marine protein or something that's going to react the same way in the fish that you're trying to raise as a system in its body to grow. So now we're doing hamachi, Forever Oceans. I say we because that's the company that I'm focused on them because I just think it's going to be.
Is that the Hawaiian group out of Kona?
No. They started in Kona. They did a test, test pilot run out in Kona and did get a generation out of there and had great success with it. I tasted.
Yeah, no, I know that I've seen all. That's they've done a phenomenal job mm-hmm. with that. I would call more R&D at this point with that Kona stuff, right?
Well, no, we're about ready to, Forever Oceans is about ready to release.
No, I meant the Kona operation. I apologize.
Those guys
is testing and bringing in the cold water from 2,000 feet down.
It's right.
Part of the whole thing. It's an amazing. Yeah, they tried shrimping there multiple times. The blue shrimp didn't always work out. But
Right. Well, I mean, again, look, I'm 65 years old. And in my lifetime, my career, the changes that have happened in the world of aquaculture, aquaculture goes back thousands of years, but this is in China and they're blocking off areas of little lagoons and farming or planting seeds for clams, mussels, oysters, things of that nature. But in the thin fish world, it's ridiculously new, an explosion of a category of seafood that is going in different directions. Some are doing a great job, some are not doing as great a job. And that's where I'm just trying to differentiate between what do you support and what do you believe in? Well, as a chef, as a cuisinier, as a man that's been in kitchens for many, many years, that you've done volume, you've done everything, 2-star restaurants to, 3,000 people a minute in a stadium, you understand that, it's quality products that are going to set us apart from the rest. And it's flavor, it's texture, it's nutritional value, and it's the story behind it. And it's the values that company or that product has adhered to along the way. And that's, to me, it's those five, six pillars of importance that were all ticked off with Forever Oceans, which I find extremely interesting. You know,
what I would tell you, and I agree with you 100%, right? What bothers me is guys like that, you have to help encourage, and if they're not quite there, you got to help them get there, right?
Sure, sure.
Instead of disparaging people, right?
Thank you.
Not everyone's going to do it 100% right. There's a ton of it, right? But if you can't help these guys get there, then what are you doing?
Well, I'm fortunate. I call myself the Trojan chef. You know,
right,
I got
you know what I'm saying, right? Yeah, look, you've been involved in this, the Canadian company you were involved with for a while, right?
True North, yeah.
Getting involved with these guys, Marine Stewardship Council, which I got involved with and helped, right? And still do, you know, figure that out. It's important to help the ones that want to do it the right way get there. They're not going to be able to automatically get there from day one. It's ridiculous to even think that, right? I remember that there was a ton of stuff that the Pew guys would not certify that MSC wanted to, and they would battle. It was ridiculous.
Oh, there's a lot of competition in all of the environmental groups. They were fighting amongst each other. There was a time where I know there was at least 7 to 8 different guides being handed out to people in order to select more sustainably. You know, and it just, but they weren't
if
working.
If it wasn't theirs, it wasn't the right one, right?
That's exactly, yeah.
It's kind of like, I'm sorry, it's very easy. It's kind of like a lawyer. I never met a lawyer wrote a contract that read a contract that he didn't write that he liked. If he didn't write it, it wasn't a good contract.
That's right.
The end of the discussion, right? Oh, well, it could have been this. Oh, it could have had, it's like, leave it alone, right?
But that was, everybody was tearing each other down, rather than figuring how to celebrate making it better. And I was part of both sides of this. I was screaming over here, we got to stop this. This is terrible. Just, you know, and it wasn't a boycott.
Yeah, right?
Swordfish, exactly what I was talking about. You know, it wasn't a boycott. It was just give it a break. Give it a break, you know. And just choose a couple other fish that you want to eat on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday rather than swordfish. It was the population and the fact that there was a lot more to it.
I remember. And I will tell you because at the same time, right, I was working with, and I'm not bringing up names or anything, a group, a very large seafood chain that I convinced to take Orange Ruffy off the menu, cost them $500,000 to change menus.
Wow.
And zero recognition from any environment. He did it because it was the right thing. I brought it to his attention. Right. The things that he was talking about back then, you know, with the bycatch and all that, they just don't get it. Right.
But what was on? But well, this is marketing too. Marketing had a lot to do with the over exploitation of specific fish that we would
look at redfish. Right.
But what was Orange Ruffy called originally?
It was an ugly name. I don't remember.
Right? Slime head. You know, and it's because these names were given to seafood from fishermen, I'm pretty sure. Hey, Jeff, what'd you catch today out in the water? I got a bunch of slime heads, a couple of Bluetooth knuckleheads, and you know, they had all these crazy names, not good for marketing. No. So then when Orange Ruffy came out, some brilliant person to change the name, that poor fish that didn't hit sexual maturity till it was like 25 years old or something ridiculous like that.
Almost like a grouper family. Right, I think.
Right. So they can't, how is that going to be sustainable if we're just eating like, because it's the new coolest thing, massive quantities, you know, I think as a population now, we're educated enough to realize the importance of omega-3s and the importance of high quality omega-3s and the knowledge that you're going to pay a little bit more, but I don't think we're quite there yet with aquaculture, the understanding and of really the power that it has to help the indigenous wild species that we love as well, and still produce what the demand, which has been exponentially going in upward direction.
Two things there, right? One, climate is for real. Climate change.
Yes.
The water is getting warmer. So if we don't figure out aquaculture and ways to do this different areas, there's not going to be anything.
Well, I'm going to send you some fish, my friend.
Yeah.
I want you to try it out. I want your honest opinion of it, because I know you're more than qualified to give me that kind of feedback. I think you'd be quite impressed, but I'm not trying to influence you. That's not true. I am trying to influence you, but I mean, I'm not going
to
influence
New York, you.
You don't bullshit a New Yorker. That's just the way it is, you know?
But think, on your thing with the Orange Roughy, if you think about it, right, Mike? You know, as you know, Paul Prudhomme ended up pretty much being my godfather. You know, we were as close as two people ever could be. Mm-hmm. I was very fortunate when I met him when I was on the Olympic team, but we became like family.
Right.
And one of his biggest regrets was wiping out redfish.
Right. Pan blackened redfish. That pan blackening became wildly successful, wildly popular, you know, and I don't know.
They found out one species.
Yeah, for taking a bunch of spices and making them even more bitter, but everybody loved it. I don't know why, you know, burn the fish. But it was amazing because he had the right species of fish to do it with. You can't.
That's why.
100%. And so I have nothing but total respect for Paul Prudhomme.
No, I know you do. But I'm saying, right, and we've done enough stuff together, right? Mm-hmm. But that being said, right, that one fish, particularly because of the fatty, because of the strong flavor, that thing was perfect for that seasoning. And before that, it was rarely used, right? Same thing. It wasn't a popular fish.
Well, here we go now. So here we are today. Let's talk about hamachi, for instance. I didn't know hamachi. You know, amberjack. You didn't see it on menus. It was Dover sole. It was, you know, there was a handful of items. And I think a lot of the effort of what I've been trying to see happen in this world is there's hundreds of thousands of species of fish in the ocean that we don't see. We don't put them on our table. So we need to be able to introduce, we meaning chefs, the hospitality industry can embrace and introduce in manners that the general public can be okay, because they're a little closed-minded. You know, they want three species of fish. That's all I want. I'll get my omegas from tuna, salmon, and swordfish, whatever, because they're comfortable, they're available, and I love them. But so now let's try hamachi. Thank goodness for the popularization of sushi restaurants, you know, raw and well-presented, more diverse species of fish. Fish that people didn't see on their table every day. And so I think I know that we're much closer to people understanding. And so like Forever Oceans, the hamachi that we have, I mean, you could pick us a way of cooking cuisine. You could roast it. You could poach it. You could grill it. You could broil it. You know, there's you could fry it. And of course, the raw option is certainly there as well. I mean, I'm going to be going to Washington, D.C., in a few days. I don't know the timing of this podcast, but may have already been come back by the time this goes on the air, but to do some cooking demonstrations.
Capitol Hill Oceans Week, right?
What's that?
For Capitol Hill Oceans Week?
No, not actually, yes. It's timed around that so that, you know, there's already a pre-interested audience that we can attract to introduce a new product to. It's all marketing. You got to be smart about where you place it, who you get to sample it. But to me, what in the history of seafood, aquaculture or otherwise, very, very poor history of celebrating success. For so many years, it was always reacting to the sudden concern on a species of fish that they are dealing
with. Overreaction.
Correct. So transparency, tell everybody what you're doing. Look, here it is. Here's how we raise it. This is why we do this. This is the environmental impact. This is how it's better for the people that live in the area and where we're doing our business. All of the factors, put it right out there so no one can go, but wait a minute. I think you've got a smoking gun, and then they have to go scramble around to react. And it's too late at that point. People have already rejected it.
Especially with social media and everything these days, it's a bit ridiculous.
Yeah. Well, you know, so.
With no facts.
Those are the things that I'm pushing. Those are the things that I want to see happen. I would love to see integrated multi-trophic aquaculture, which is when you'll have a species that you're farming. And it's really more than that environment was designed to support that that much biomass, even though the conditions are perfect, it still has byproducts that are detrimental, you know, be it effluent that falls to the bottom, the combination of fish that don't make it with food that wasn't eaten, along with everything else that goes, it turns into a toxic scenario. But there's a lot of things that would also benefit greatly from that high concentration, toxic to the environment, that would love that, such as kelp or mussels. Right. And so from you taking species that are on different trophic levels, right, parts of the food chain, the easiest way to see it, and put them in the same area and let them benefit from each other. And because that's how nature would do it. If this were to happen in nature on its own without, you know, putting a cage up or whatever to keep them from escaping, nature would find a way on its own. So we can accelerate and project down the road. And to me, IMTA, Integrated Multitrophic Agriculture, is one of the things I hope to see become a big success in my lifetime.
And I would tell you, because you're an expert right on the wild side, what is not being promoted or done right either is looking at the quotas in each area and seeing what's not coming close. What's not a popular fish that the quota isn't even close to push that a little bit more to take some of the pressure off the other stuff too.
You look at Maine. Okay, what is Maine known for? Number one, first thing, Maine.
Lobster.
Correct. Now, lobster's been farmed there for a long time, but guess what? Maine's in trouble because of the climate change. Water temperature's changing. Where are the lobsters going? Yeah. They're going north, just like cod went north out of the Georges Banks. Now they're in Iceland. So it's going up in the air. So what's left over, you know, in a culture that is generally a little stubborn, all right? I'm going to say that about New England because I live there. Not because I read it in a book, you know, I'm not changing. This is the way it is. But these cave, you know, the lobster traps are entangling and bringing this a species of whales to an incredibly dangerous level. And we historically go, I don't eat whales. What do I care? So I want more lobster. Bring me more lobster. Well, unfortunately, that's just not the reality of the ecosystem. Everything plays an integral role. You don't pull a piece of your car engine out and expect the engine to run the same. This is ugly. I'm going to throw this out. Boom. And you wonder why there's a problem with your car. So it doesn't matter if it's a whale or something else. They all were placed in that environment to work in symbiosis. So this is a big problem because, you know, now I'm not changing. And, you know, NOAA, who sets the quotas, you know, seeing that, okay, it's, you know, when there's 2,000 whales, that's when we're in deep trouble. Well, it's like less than 2,000 whales. So something needs to be done right away. And so
you can't even get a real count. I mean, let's be honest. I mean, it's just a little.
It's a lot of information. There's a lot. I mean, there's a continuous.
I'm just saying, right? Even in Alaska, there's a bunch of species other than salmon, right? That can be figured out, right? There's a lot more things out there, but like you said, they're stubborn. And I think it takes great chefs like yourself to look at promoting and figuring out that on the menus. But you also have to, it's pulling teeth, because then you got to get the guy to fish it.
Yeah.
And you got to get the guy to process it, right? Because he's terrified that he's not going to get his money. So it reverts back to what I'm trying to do, is to look at that, get these guys guaranteed purchase contracts.
Mm-hmm.
On a 5-year clip.
Well, you can do that. You know, an independent restaurant, they just look at it and go, it's futile, you know?
Right, but it takes guys, but our industry has been always really good at it in a sense, right? The top filters down. I celebrate, like you do, the Eric Repairs, the Rene Rezepis from Noma, all these guys on that level, because that type of cooking, that dedication of furthering our craft, you know, does filter down eventually, right?
Yeah, yeah.
The stuff that was sous vide, no one knew what the hell it was 20 years ago. Mm. Now it's pretty common.
Right.
That's just one example, but it takes guys like Rezepi, fermentation. I mean, nothing everything old is new again, always, right, Kyle? but fermentation is now, because of NOMA, and that, look, Molecular went out. Personally, I'm grateful. I was not a huge fan. Right. Audrey did an amazing job with it, but the difference between him and most others, he took a year to figure it out and spent time in his R&D lab. He had classical cooking behind him and basically put twists on that to come up with the molecular stuff, right? Other guys were screwing around with it, didn't understand it, putting chemicals and stuff, and it wasn't quite there. The flavor profile, the level of execution wasn't that of an Audrey or guys on that level.
Well, if I can't pronounce an ingredient in the food that I'm serving or consuming myself, I lose my interest very, very quickly.
Right. So the fermentation going back the opposite direction, which mm-hmm. what they do in Scandinavia and all that forever, right? Preserving food.
Garum, yeah. I mean, come on.
Is, right. Garum's, it's phenomenal, right? And it has a better depth of flavor and it's go on and on and on, right?
Sure.
Now there's a little bit of a hybrid between the two, right? But the molecular stuff is, it had its time, right? But at the end of the day, solid cooking is solid cooking.
Right on, baby.
Does it taste good?
Great product, simple preparation, you know, and with a story behind it and a reason for supporting it is really all we're all looking for, I think, Jeff. I've kept you for over an hour now. So, I mean, you're my friend. It's great to see your face. It's great to talk to you. But your career, I've learned a lot more, even though I've known you for so many years, having an hour with you right now. I just want to thank you from the bottom of my heart.
And I just want to, real quick, because it's important to me and it's important to what we've been doing for the last couple of years, right?
Decades.
We haven't addressed the, look, we both made it this far. That's pretty good, right? 2 years ago when this thing hit, I wasn't too sure. We all lost loved ones, right?
Yes.
We all pivoted. So we got involved and I got involved in feeding Native Americans in the Northwest and doing the food boxes and that, which I think is...
That's awesome.
It really gave me more purpose, right? Mm-hmm. It helped me understand another culture that I knew very little about.
You're talking Yupiks?
It's the Confederated Tribes of the Columbia River Gorge.
Okay.
Is what Justin Zollner from the Wave Foundation and I have been focused on, one of many things in the Northwest. But once the pandemic hit, we fed Nez Perce, Yakima Nation, Warm Springs, and many others.
Wow.
Doing deliveries every week, 1,500 boxes of food with about 40 pounds in them. Literally making sure that the food that these people were getting was culturally relevant.
Right.
So it makes perfect sense that they were getting government boxes, right? As everyone was, a lot of people, right? And it was a mandate for dairy in there. Well, most tribal members are lactose intolerant, which makes perfect sense. They're nomads, right? They didn't travel with cows.
Nope.
No. So they never drank milk.
No, it was just we drink milk as children from our mother's breast. And once that dries up, that's the lactose that you needed in your life to go for the rest of your life. I mean, you know, unless you live in Holland or Dutch.
You're getting calcium from fish, right?
Right.
And other things, or spinach or different things, right? So you weren't. Anyway, so it was a really interesting learning experience doing that, right? Mm-hmm. And it still is. We're finishing up that program here in the next month and wrapping that up. But Food Fleet itself has been involved for many years supporting the entire BIPOC community and ensuring, and I started the company that you came to UCLA and helped me way back in the day, right? And did that dinner.
Yeah.
That was quite the experience.
I love it.
But that was, that was crazy. But I appreciate you coming and supporting me there. But we work with thousands of small minority-owned businesses and give them an opportunity now to participate at these stadiums, arenas, universities, hospitals, and help these guys make a living. And we're able to start telling their stories, which all comes down to, like you said, a healthy food supply, sustainable small farms, small agriculture, small aquaculture, large aquaculture, right? Mm-hmm. And wild, and keeping it within that realm. And it's what's next
for me. Oh, you know what? Let's figure it out, man. Let's feed this planet, Jeff. I love you, brother. I'm going to sign off.
Thanks for letting me finish up.
It's my pleasure. Anytime.
All right, buddy.
Take care.
Take care. Bye.
Bye.
ForeverOceans.com